please subscribe and don't forget to press the bell icon to get notified whenever we upload a new video.
A great setting to get one of the most prominent voices in emerging market and India investing. We are cutting across to Anuj and Sonia, who are speaking to veteran India investor Mark Mobius of Templeton EM Group. Over to you guys.
Hello and welcome to this special conversation that we are having with Mark Mobius, Executive Chairman, Templeton Emerging Market Group, who of course is in India. I am Anuj and with me of course is Sonia.
Mark, good morning. Thanks a lot for joining us. Welcome to India.
Thank you.
How's your stay been so far in Mumbai?
Excellent. Very good.
Any more pollution than when you visited last time?
Well, we're looking at a number of new positions, that's for sure.
Okay. Mark, you know, to begin the conversation, I'll just go back to your last blog and I'll just borrow one phrase from there. While there are some risks in the distance that needs to be watched carefully, we think emerging market stocks still hold much potential, especially if we step away from the idea that emerging market investing is purely commodity-based. Emerging markets have had a huge rally also this year.
Yes.
India has been part of that. Do you reckon that it has legs to go in terms of multi-year bull market?
Oh, definitely. An interesting point you mentioned about commodities.
Yes.
You know, a lot of people have said, well, if commodities are down, emerging markets can't do well. Well, commodities are down and emerging markets are doing very well. So I think that's one of the mistakes that people make. They tie the performance of emerging markets to any particular variable. A lot of people were worried about interest rates. You know, they said that if interest rates in America go up, emerging markets will be in trouble. Well, if you go back 10 years, you'll find there's very little correlation, consistent correlation. Sometimes interest rates go up and the market goes up.
Yes.
Sometimes the opposite. You know, you have this a very different behavior, and you really can't rely on that one variable.
Mm-hmm.
But I think going forward, we're now midway through a bull market, which will continue into 2018, 2019. Yes.
Okay. Midway through the bull market. So
I would say about midway through. Yeah.
A lot of people think we might be at the, you know, start of a 2003 to 2007 kind of cycle. Do you think it's different? We've already reached halfway through that bull market?
No, because if you look at the history, 2007, if you look at any of the indices, emerging market indices, you'll see that we're now below that high in 2007. Mm-hmm. And we could see about a 20% excess above that 2007 high.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got a ways to go.
Mark, it's great to have you here in India. I'm going to come back to that argument about the emerging markets and where India fits in. But before that, generally when you come to India, you meet a lot of companies. Have you managed to do that this time around? And if yes, what has your takeaway been?
Well, I've met the one company and I hope to meet another one this afternoon. So I don't have much time. Unfortunately, I have to leave tomorrow.
Okay.
But we have our analysts on the ground who are looking at many, many companies. And the changes are quite remarkable,
okay.
Mainly brought on by the internet and smartphones, the
okay.
technology that's being introduced into India by the mass of the Indian population is having a big, big impact on every company. Every company has to pay attention
mm.
to what's happening in that space.
Mm. So which are the companies, which is the company that you met and you plan to meet as well?
I met Reliance, not as a to do an in-depth analysis, but just to get an idea of how things were going with their cell phone business
okay.
and with the 3G, 4G, and all the other iterations that are taking place in that space. And, of course, I've been a big fan for quite some time because when they were first laying the fiber, a lot of people were pessimistic,
mm.
and I was not because I believe that it was a very good plan that had long-term implications,
okay.
and we're now beginning to see that play out.
So does telecom as a space interest you in India over the next, say, 2 to 3 years?
Definitely. Well, when we say telecoms, it's now becoming data comms, you might say,
okay.
in the sense that it's not only speaking on the phone, but it's the tremendous amount of data that's being pushed through these pipes.
Okay.
And the use of that data is going to have tremendous implications in every field,
okay.
whether it be medical, financial, social, you just name it, and we're in that situation where things are changing very rapidly. And you're getting a situation where in the hinterlands, in the rural areas of India, they are leapfrogging
yeah.
into the newest technology, which is quite remarkable.
Okay, and which is the other company that you plan to meet, Mark?
Not not any public company. We're looking at private equity in a big way, so we're looking at private companies.
Okay. Now let's broaden the theme a bit. This morning you've been tweeting about China, and especially the way China's leadership is, pursuing key reforms. Is China a preferred market for you compared to India right now?
China is larger simply because it is larger in the sense that there are more companies that we can buy in China with larger market capitalizations. But India is a close second. Mm. So in other words, if you look at India in relation to China, India GDP, about 20% of China's, but our weighting in the market is much higher than that in India, because we believe that going forward, India will be moving at a faster pace and will represent a larger and larger percent of relationship to China.
Yeah, the reason I brought that point is because in India we have had a couple of key reforms, right, with GST, and it, a lot of people believe that it was a gutsy reform, and there could be price to pay politically for the Prime Minister in a couple of state elections. Would that be a bit of a setback? We are heading into election season for India, so could that be a bit of a speed breaker for our bull market?
Not really, because we believe that the current administration in India has been very clever in implementing reforms with the understanding that they will continue to implement changes as they go. Mm-hmm. They made the choice that, look, we're not going to get everything perfect and everything ready right now, but we're going to jump in because we've been waiting too long for these reforms, and we're going to then have iterations installed as we see problems arise. So I think this will stand them in good stead going forward, because by the time the election comes along, they will have corrected a lot of the problems that people have faced with the new regulations.
What is the biggest risk in your mind to this market? What will make you sit up and take notice? Will it be a geopolitical tension, something to do with North Korea?
Of course, with North Korea, anything can happen, particularly now with the American administration wanting to take some action in some direction. So, you might have a situation where the Americans shoot down one of North Korea's missiles, and that creates a crisis. So you could have something like that at any time, and we've got to be ready for that. And, of course, it will have a global impact, not only on emerging markets, but everybody. The good news is that India has a path of its own, in the sense that there's a lot of domestic activity taking place that's driving this tremendous growth and interest. So in some ways, India will not be impacted as much as, let's say, Japan might be or some of the other countries in the world.
So in that sense, does India stand out as one of your top emerging market ideas, even through the course of 2018?
Yes. If you look at our portfolios, you'll see India's right up there. Usually it's second or third after China. So India is definitely up there and growing at a faster pace.
Mark, slightly unrelated topic here. What's happening with the world of cryptocurrencies, and with Bitcoin in particular? And you're talking about huge market caps now. Is there a risk of some bit of money moving from the equities as an asset class to this new asset class, which is now gaining traction and now is getting listed on CME as well, so maybe, getting recognized as well?
Well, when people ask me to talk about cryptocurrencies, I always tell them, I don't like to talk about religion in public. But in fact, I was telling a youngster who was trading in Bitcoin, I said, Bitcoin is giving tulips a bad name.
So that's true.
This is the problem that you have, is that on the one side, you have a whole generation of youngsters who believe in the internet, have been living the internet from their childhood. And when they see a cryptocurrency, they think nothing of adopting it because they've been adopting other things on the internet. So I see a real need, of course, that cryptocurrencies are meeting. And that is a way of rapidly transferring value across the internet without anyone knowing who you are and what you're doing. There's a real need. And it doesn't have to be necessarily a illicit need, although a lot of illicit transactions are taking place. But then you've got to separate that transmission to the value proposition. In other words, is it really valuable? Is it worth something? And that, of course, is not the case.
Okay.
Because Bitcoins don't have that background.
So do you think that we're in a bubble as far as the Bitcoin movement is concerned? Or is there still a lot of money to be made here?
Oh, there's a bubble brewing. In fact, just today it went up again.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, there's no question it's a bubble brewing. But, you know, you have to wait. Usually bull markets or bubbles end in euphoria. Yeah. When everybody is euphoric about the particular market you're talking about. And we haven't reached that stage yet because people like us are kind of skeptical, you know.
Yes.
It's when we start trading in this, that's when you're going to see the bubble burst.
Oh, yes. You know, there are a couple of exchanges in India who have stopped, you know, opening new accounts because of the kind of surge that you're seeing. But anyway, let's get back to the topic that we are discussing, equities. Indian equity markets have seen a lot of domestic participation, Mark, through the last 1 year. And that's so refreshing for us, you know, to see so much domestic money getting into equities. And we have withstood so much foreigner selling in secondary market, at least. Your thoughts on whether this is likely to be the trend going forward, that a lot of domestic savings will be channeled into equities and foreigners will slowly or surely take the money out and move to the other markets where they're getting better traction?
This happens very often in many parts of the world. You see that happen. The foreigners come in first, and then they generate liquidity and their new listings and new IPOs. And then the local investors begin to get interested. They come in, and they then begin to dominate the market. And foreigners say, well, wait a minute, it's getting expensive. I'm going to get out and take some profits. But very often they're wrong, because the domestic investors continue to push up the market. Yes. And the foreigners say, gee, why did I go out? I'm getting back in again. Mm. So you're going to see this kind of trend, I think, in India as well. Because the domestic market is growing at a fast pace. You must remember now, more and more Indians are moving beyond the subsistence phase. Mm-hmm. In other words, they have enough to eat, they have a house, they have enough clothing, they have education for their children, and they have excess cash that they have to invest. And that's where you're going to see a big increase. You've seen that in China, mm-hmm. and you're going to see that here. Mm-hmm. So as foreign investors, we have to pay attention to that because, as I said, until euphoria steps in, then there's probably good opportunities to buy.
But do you see this foreign money returning? To be fair, it's getting invested in primary markets, getting invested in QIPs and block deals.
Yes.
But in listed secondary market, we have seen quite a bit of sell-off. Do you see that money coming back?
Yes, this is temporary. You must remember that as the Indian market grows, its weighting in the indices increases. Mm-hmm. When that happens, about, I would say, almost half of all fund money from overseas has to invest because they are indexing. Mm-hmm. You know, the rise of the ETFs is quite amazing the way they've grown. Money now pouring into funds around the world is mostly going into ETFs, mm-hmm. index funds. These index funds have to invest according to the index. So as India's market cap increases, they will have to put more money in. Okay. So you're always going to have that. Now, the other important point is that the degree to which the government is able to privatize mm-hmm. more and more state-owned enterprises means that the market capitalization of India will grow and they will take a bigger share of the index.
I'm going to come back to the kind of potential you see for India particularly over the next 1 year. But before that, what's your take on what's happening with the U.S. with respect to that tax cuts bill and the kind of repercussions it could have on other economies as well?
Well, this is having a big impact. I mean, if you think about the amount of money that will come back into the U.S., you must remember that you have examples of Apple. They're talking about the savings, hundreds of millions of dollars of savings as a result of the tax bill, of their overseas holdings. Because a lot of companies have billions of dollars outside the America and has not returned because of the high tax. Mm-hmm. Now with the halving of the tax, they will bring that in. Yeah. But it won't stay in America. Okay. That will, of course, recapitalize some of the companies, but a lot of that money will flow back out again into investments.
But do you see money move out of, say, emerging markets into markets like the U.S.?
Well, most of this money is not in emerging markets.
Okay.
It's in fixed income in developed countries, Europe, UK, like that. So it's not going to have an impact in emerging markets from what I can see of any great significance. There's some in emerging markets, but not that much. So in some ways, it will be beneficial to emerging markets.
Okay, let's talk a bit more about India then, Mark. For years, your biggest bet has been HDFC Bank, and in your funds, in the private sector banks and private sector financials, they have dominated portfolio. Of course, they have dominated the index as well. Do you think that will remain the dominant theme as far as the Indian market is concerned?
I think there's going to be more of a shift towards the state-owned banks.
Okay.
Because of the recapitalization that's taking place that mm-hmm. the government is implementing, that'll make these state-owned banks look more attractive.
Wow, that you've given us a big headline. So you are moving some money to state-owned banks?
To the state-owned banks.
Okay.
Be more in that direction.
But you don't think that, there's a belief that they will once again make the same mistakes and once again get into trouble?
They will. There's no question about that. But it's going to take about 5 years for that to happen. I mean, I know the government has said, look, they've made banking reforms and it won't happen again. But you and I know that this is bound to happen, that, they'll get careless again. But the good news is at least they, once you recognize the problem, mm-hmm. which this government has, mm-hmm. and have tried to do something to ameliorate it, to do something to correct the problem, that's a huge step in the right direction. So I believe, going forward, it won't be as bad as what we've seen before. And the degree to which the government is able to further sell shares of the state-owned enterprises, the banks, that will also help. Because, one of the key themes nowadays is governance. Mm-hmm. We are under tremendous pressure from our clients who say, look, we want you to work on governance, we want you to work on the environment, we want you to work on social issues, ESG. So that's a big theme going forward, and you're going to see foreign investors as well as domestic investors putting pressure on these companies and banks to behave themselves and not go overboard.
So would we be looking at you putting fresh money into PSU banks, or would it be moving money from private to PSU?
It'll probably just be a natural growth. In other words, as we are growing, as more money comes into our funds, we will naturally put more money into the state banks.
Okay. The other big theme that you've played on is commodities, especially global commodities.
Yes.
Are you still looking at a surge in commodity prices, and how would that correlate with what's happening with the Indian metal stocks?
Well, you've already seen a surge in some prices. If you look at the commodity index, you'll see it came down, and now it's sort of puttering along at the bottom. But if you look at some individual commodities, they've spurred it ahead. Mm. You must remember, when you're starting from a low base, the percentages can be tremendous. Mm. A lot of people don't realize that from the absolute bottom, oil prices have gone up by 90%.
Yeah.
If you look at palladium, one of my favorites is palladium, because it's used as a catalytic converter for gasoline engines. And of course, China is still producing millions of gasoline engine cars. That commodity has gone through the roof. It's really gone up. And certain other commodities, like components for batteries, those commodities are going up a lot. So I believe that you're going to see a recovery of commodities, simply because, the demand for commodities is not stopping. Mm-hmm. The demand continues. A good example is China. A lot of people say, China's importing less iron ore. Well, yeah, in value terms, it's gone down. But in quantity, it's gone up. Okay. If you look at the two charts, in value, it's like this. In quantity, it's like this. Mm-hmm. Continue to go up, simply because the demand is still there.
So is that a risk for India as well? Because we are a commodity-consuming country. We import 90% of our oil requirement.
Yeah.
That was a trigger for last correction in India as well. So is that a risk for India then?
It is a risk, because if you have a big demand, and you're going to have a growing demand with a growing country, mm-hmm. at the rate you're growing, you're going to have demand for more commodities. The good news is that there are a lot of commodities in this country that are not exploited. Mm-hmm. And the degree to which the government can unleash some of those commodities could have a big impact on, on what's happening locally.
So what would you be referring to? What kind of commodities?
Iron ore. Think about it.
Yeah.
You've got plenty of iron ore. You've got plenty of coal. I don't know how much offshore oil and gas or onshore oil and gas you might have, but I'm sure it's there. So, and there's probably a lot of undiscovered commodities that are in this country. It's a big country. There's a lot going on. So the good news, by the way, is with the government's policy of giving more autonomy to the states. I believe the states will be more apt to explore for the opportunities within their own states and unleash some of this potential.
Okay. Two strong pillars of India's economy over the last decade had been IT and pharmaceuticals.
Yes.
We have seen a bit of a problem for both these sectors, Mark, though they've started to recover as well. Do you think the structural story is over in Indian IT or pharma or both? Or do you think it was just a temporary phase of weakness and these companies would be back to where they were, say, about 3 or 4 years back?
No, I think the story with IT and pharma was that many other industries found it very, very difficult to export because of the restrictions. You know, the good thing about the GST is that these restrictions will be released. It'll be easier to transport out of the country and so forth. So someone told me that if you wanted to go from one state to another, the cost would be as much as shipping to Brazil. You know, that sort of problem. So a lot of that has been ameliorated. And so it was easy to go into the IT space because you're not transporting anything. You're just broadcasting around the world. And the same thing with pharmaceuticals. Very small, easy to ship, no big deal. So in that sense, those industries will continue because they have a very strong position globally already. And they're not going to give that up. That won't. But in relationship to other industries, they probably will take of the total, it will be a smaller percent. But the other thing you've got to remember is that the domestic demand is going to be increasing for both of those industries.